عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. So we are on hadith number 26, right? Hadith number 26. Last week we spoke about the justice that exists between, in the dynamics between parents and children in regards to the love and the admiration that's to be shown towards the parents and the obedience that's to be shown towards the parents without sacrificing the justice that's owed to the children. And obviously, you know, that's a balance that's very hard to strike, but it's not impossible. And so it's something that the Prophet ﷺ frequently spoke about. It's something that's frequently mentioned in the Quran, this unconditional love and obedience that you have towards the parents. Now, as I said, the next few lectures, what we're going to do is we're going to focus on the family dynamics, because family is part of the entire discussion of social justice, because you cannot be just with those on the outside of your home, but be a tyrant within. And there are many a hadith in regards to this dynamic, and what I wanted to focus on today was the sin of favoritism. So treating one of your children in preferential fashion, giving, you know, for whatever reason that may be. So either differentiating based on just the first child versus the second child, or boys versus girls, or whatever it may be, and how that really plays out in different ways. And if you don't have children, then this still will benefit you, inshallah ta'ala. And this isn't meant to be something for you to go back and call your parents up and be like, you never gave me this, and, you know, the sheikh said you're going to hell tonight. I'm not saying that about anybody. This is a very complicated discussion, and we take from the beneficial lessons from our Prophet, peace be upon him, in regards to all of these different dynamics that are found in these relationships. So we'll start off with a hadith. It's a hadith that's narrated by An-Nu'man ibn al-Bashir, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So An-Nu'man ibn al-Bashir, he says that my father wanted to give me a gift, but my mother, Amra, she stepped in and she said that she would not agree to him giving me that gift unless the Prophet, peace be upon him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, witnessed it, meaning he approved of it. So he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the father of An-Nu'man ibn Bashir, and he said to him, he said, listen, I have a gift that I was going to give my son, but at the same time, my wife Amra objected to that gift unless you were made witness to it. And the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam responded, and he said, have you given to, or actually in one narration he said, do you have any other children? And he said, yes. And he said, have you given them the like of what you have given him? Are you giving to your other children the like of what you are giving him? And the father of An-Nu'man ibn Bashir responded in the negative. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ, so be mindful of your Lord, وَأَعْدِلُوا بَيْنَ أَوْلَادِكُمْ, and be just with your children. And he said in some of the narrations, he says, فَلَا تُشْهِدْنِي إِذًا فَإِنِّي لَا أَشْهَدُ عَلَى جَوْرِ. The Prophet ﷺ said, do not make me a witness to your giving this gift then, because I do not bear witness to oppression or to injustice. Those are really strong words for the Prophet ﷺ to refuse to witness a father giving his child a gift, because he said, you have failed to do the same with your other children. Speaking of children, whoever has got the children in the back, inshallah, you can do justice by bringing them all out from the back so that they're not behind me, inshallah. So the Prophet ﷺ said, do not have preferential treatment in regards to how you give gifts. And it was even a problem to give a gift to only one child. So if you're going to give a gift to one child, you need to make sure that other children are receiving something like it. He didn't say the exact same thing. So it's not like if you're buying a gift for a girl that's specific to a girl, you need to buy the exact same thing for your son, if you have a girl and a boy. But something like it, something that is similar to it in its value, something that's similar to it in regards to the enjoyment that a child would find from it. And this is a narration that comes in many different forms. The particular one that I just mentioned is in al-Bukhari. There's in the Muslim Imam Ahmed, for example, the Prophet ﷺ said three times, اعدلوا بين أبنائكم, اعدلوا بين أبنائكم, اعدلوا بين أبنائكم. Be just with your children, be just with your children, be just with your children. In al-Tabarani, the Prophet ﷺ says, similar things. And in fact, he says, اعدلوا بين أولادكم, be just with your children in the same way that you would want them to be just with you. So be just with your children in the same way that you would want them to be just with you. So honor your children in the same way that you'd like to be honored by them. That's a very beautiful way of the Prophet ﷺ to put it. Because usually when you think about those narrations, treat people as you would like to be treated. You don't think about that in this, you know, in regards to those that are inferior in regards to the dynamics of the family. But the Prophet ﷺ is saying that in the same way you'd want to be treated, you should too treat your children. And a lot of times, by the way, you know, abused children turn out to be abusive parents. And that cycle simply never ends. So the Prophet ﷺ is applying a principle that we usually speak of in regards to our outside relations, to the way that we deal with one another within our families. And this hadith has so many different variations and additions, none of them contradicting one another, but more context that's given in some of the longer narrations, that Imam al-Nasa'i, rahimahullah ta'ala, actually has a chapter on all of the variations of this particular hadith, the khabar, the narration of Nu'man ibn al-Bashir, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So how do we apply this in different forms? All right, or what are the practical manifestations of this? The scholars say that this is not simply referring to how you distribute gifts or what you give to your children financially. But they said this even applies in tarheeb and taqbeel, even in the way that you welcome your children, even in the way that you emotionally give to your children. And Ibrahim al-Nakhai, rahimahullah ta'ala, the Shaykh of al-Bukhari, the teacher of al-Bukhari, he said that the companions used to encourage justice amongst the children even in proportion of kisses, even in the way that you would kiss your children, and not give anyone more food than the others except for some sort of reason that's been specified. So even in regards to kisses and emotional well-being, the companions of the Prophet ﷺ would pay attention to that. Now that's a major shift in the culture of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ. Why? Because we know this very famous narration. One time, the Prophet ﷺ was playing with his kids, and he started to kiss them. He was playing with Al-Hassan and Hussein, his grandkids, and he kissed them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there was a man that looks at the Prophet ﷺ and is like, you kiss your kids? Like, that's weird. Why do you kiss your kids? He said, I have 10 of them, and I've never kissed any of them. I've got 10 kids, and I've never kissed any of them. And the Prophet ﷺ said, what can I do of a man who has no mercy in his heart? That's a natural loving feeling that used to be that used to be looked down upon amongst the Arabs, and the Prophet ﷺ is saying, no, that's something that you should express publicly. So the companions now are so attuned into the dynamics of justice in their lives that they're paying attention to how much they kiss their kids and if they're distributing those kisses equally. And yes, you know, that even if your kid doesn't like to be kissed, you're like, puts their face away like, mom, dad, stop. You gotta make them enjoy it, inshallah ta'ala. So you've got to make sure that you maintain that loving relationship between all of your kids as much as you can. There are other narrations that are very beautiful, and this one I absolutely love. To be honest with you, I never heard of this narration until today. It's a hadith that's mursal, narrated by Al-Hassan radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And Al-Hassan describes this incident with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says that بينما رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يحدث أصحابه, while the Prophet, peace be upon him, was speaking to his companions or teaching his companions, he said صلى الله عليه وسلم إذ جاء صبي حتى انتهى إلى أبيه. He said a young boy walked in and walked up to his father. So he said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, or he said that this companion فمسح رأسه. He wiped the head of his child, or he caressed the hair of his son. وَأَقْعَدَهُ عَلَى فَخْذِهِ, and then he sat him down on his lap. So far, this is good, right? So far, this is a positive thing. He says, فَلَبِثَ قَلِيلًا فَجَاءَتْ إِبْنَةً لَهُ, said that some time passed. جَاءَتْ, then a young girl came to him, meaning his daughter came to him as well. So he said, فَمَسَحَ رَأْسَهَا فَأَقْعَدَهَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. So he said that he wiped her hair, you know, he caressed her hair. It wasn't a totally unloving father to his daughter. But then he sat her down on the ground. So the son's sitting on his right side, on his lap, and his daughter's sitting on the floor, even though he greeted them both, but he didn't greet them equally. So the Prophet, you know, while he's speaking, he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَهَلَّ عَلَىٰ فَخْدِكَ الْأُخْرَىٰ. Well, why don't you put her on your, don't you have another thigh to give? Why don't you put her on the other side of your lap? So Al-Hassan says, فَحَمَلَهَا عَلَىٰ فَخْدِهِ الْأُخْرَىٰ. And then he put her on his on the other side of his lap. And the Prophet ﷺ said, الآن عدلت. Now you've shown justice. Now you've been fair to your kids. Meaning the Prophet, peace be upon him, is paying attention even to something as small as that. And teaching his companions that don't even put one of them on your lap and the other one on the ground. Try to fit them both if you can. And this is something the Prophet ﷺ himself used to do. Now we know that Al-Hassan and Al-Hussein were the two beloved ones of the Prophet, peace be upon him. Those were his grandkids and they're the two beloved ones of the Prophet ﷺ. But there's another grandson in the sense of Usama ibn Zayd, the son of the adopted son of the Prophet ﷺ, even though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it so that his name would be Zayd ibn al-Haritha instead of Zayd ibn Muhammad, and that lineage would be preserved, the Prophet ﷺ still treated Usama ibn Zayd the exact same way. So he said that when the Prophet ﷺ used to see me, he'd put me on one of his thighs, and then he'd put Al-Hassan on the other one of his thighs, and then he embraced us, and he said, Allahumma arhamhuma fa inni arhamuhuma. Oh Allah, be merciful to them as I am merciful to them. Meaning, love them like I love these two. And the Prophet ﷺ would embrace his kids and he would make sure to show them that equal treatment, not favoring Al-Hassan over Usama in any of those contexts or making any one of them feel like they're less loved. The Prophet ﷺ recognized that and he paid attention to that in every way. And this is something that the scholars comment on, that it might be that there is a natural love or attachment to one of your kids. You vibe, if you have more than one kid, you vibe better with one of your kids and you naturally feel that attachment. Usually it's, you know, if there's a girl that's closer to the dad or a boy that's closer to the mom, those dynamics are really funny sometimes, or even if they're all girls, and the dynamics are funny sometimes where you might have an attachment to one of your kids over the other. There might just be a better relationship for whatever reason. And that even the most righteous of people had that happen to them, where sometimes they felt more attached to some of their kids than others. But that's something that's in the heart, and that's not something that would translate into injustice. So it's narrated about Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, rahimahullah ta'ala, that he had one particular son that he really, really loved. That he really, really loved. And Umar ibn Abdul Aziz had many children. So this particular son was very beloved to him. So one day he said to him, Ya fulan, wallahi inni la uhibbuk. He said, you know, oh so-and-so. They don't actually mention the name of that son in the narration. So, what, you know, he's saying to his son, you know that I love you. وَمَا أَسْتَطِيعُ أَنْ أُورِثُكَ عَلَىٰ أَخِيكَ بِلُقْمَةٍ Or أَنْ أُوثِرُكَ, sorry. And I am not, it is not possible for me to prefer you over one of your brothers by even a bite of food, with even a luqma, that I cannot let that translate into me giving you anything more than your brother, even if it's simply a bite of food. So it plays out in that regard as well, and you know, the even the greatest of people had those attachments, but at the same time they made sure to pay attention and to not let that lead to injustice. Imam Ahmad rahimahullah discussed this in the books of fiqh. He stated that if a person has more than one daughter and he gives one a certain amount of jewelry at her wedding, then an equal amount has to be given to her sisters or to her sister at her wedding. So you have to pay attention to that as well. Now, are there exceptions to this? Are there times that you're going to give more to one child than the other? And is that ever permissible? Yes or no? What are some examples? Birthdays? No, even if you want to give something to your child on their birthday, give something to their brother or sister anyway. I'm not getting into the birthdays discussion as a whole. I'm just saying that even on a birthday, you got to give both kids the same amount. What's that? Inheritance. How so? Al-dhakar wal-untha, the son and the daughter. Okay, and sometimes the daughter more than the son. in some of those equations. So sometimes the equations of inheritance would work out in a way that some children take more than others. What else? Yeah. Okay, so you live far away, so when your parents see you, they bring suitcases of stuff. But with your siblings that are around them, they're not as generous around the year. That's natural, obviously, but someone's abroad. So scholars mention things like one child being sick. So if a child is sick, or they mention that one child is unemployed or has financial difficulties or circumstances, or they mention al-gha'ib, one child is away and distant, so when you see them, there's that intense gift-giving as opposed to the children that are around, that are, you know, that are seen frequently. Or one child, you know, I found this really interesting. We talk about financial responsibility. When you look in the books of fiqh, the scholars would allow, for example, to give more to one child if one of the children is irresponsible or extravagant in their spending. So to not deprive them in a way that you would hurt them, but at the same time, you're also trying to teach your children responsibility. So to give, you know, to make sure that you don't give an irresponsible spender the same amount of money sometimes. So there are different things that come with that. Also varying ages and phases in life. You know, some people have kids that are 20 years older than their siblings. So obviously there's going to be a difference. It's not like if you're giving your 2-year-old something at the, you know, you got to give your 22-year-old the exact same thing. But these are things to generally take into consideration that we don't fall into this favoritism and differential parenting. And it's really interesting, if you look up, there's a 2013 study from the University of Toronto. They studied 400 families and the effects of favoritism. And one of the things that's really interesting, and I'm not going to go through that study, you could read it online, but one of the things that's really emphasized is that favoritism doesn't just affect the neglected child, but it actually has deep psychological ramifications for everybody in the family. It actually ruins everything in the house. So it's, you know, it has implications on the children when they become adults. It has implications on the parents themselves. That favoritism is not just a crime or a problem for the child that's not getting the equal amount of attention, not getting the equal amount of emotional support, not getting that equal amount of love. And even this sort of goes now into something that's pointed out within the Quran, even in situations where a parent does not show favoritism, envy can develop between the children that could have major harmful effects going forward. What's the greatest example of that? Yaqub alayhi salam, Jacob with his children, right? Yaqub with Yusuf and the brothers of Yusuf, okay? Yaqub and his children. Was Yaqub a bad father to the other children? I mean, you guys should answer this pretty quickly. The Prophet of Allah, was he bad to his other children? No. Did he show favoritism or preference to Yusuf alayhi salam? No, he didn't. He did not. It's not like he would tell the other brothers, why can't you be more like Yusuf? All right? It's not like he would do that. That's like the worst thing that you could do to your kids, by the way. I don't know why people think that's a good idea in parenting, to constantly shove one child's accomplishments in the face of, why can't you be more like your brother? Why can't you be more like your sister? That's not going to make them want to aspire to be like their brother or their sister. It'll make them hate their brother or their sister and resent you and feel like, you know what, your standards are impossible. Forget about you and your standards. That's not smart to do with our kids. It's not something that we find from the Prophet ﷺ. Never did when the Prophet ﷺ caught Anas radiallahu anhu slacking off instead of doing what the Prophet ﷺ sent him to do, he didn't go up to him and say, you know, Hassan and Hussein never fall short on an errand that I give them. He never told Fatima about Zainab. I mean, none of these things are narrated. Never once do you see the Prophet ﷺ showing that preference or putting down one child in the name of praising the other. But did the Prophet ﷺ have a special attachment to one of his children? Fatima radiallahu anha. It's there. But he did not favor her in action. He was still just to his kids. But the heart of the Prophet ﷺ was in Fatima radiallahu anha. She resembled the Prophet ﷺ. She was the daughter of Khadija radiallahu anha. She had a special place with the Prophet ﷺ, there's no doubt. But you never put down one child in the name of praising another child. All right? So then someone might say, well, with Yaqub's sons, look what happened. He didn't praise. In fact, he told Yusuf, alayhi salam, when Yusuf had the dream, he told Yusuf, لا تقصص رؤياك على إخوتك. Don't tell your dream to your brothers, فَيَكِيدُ لَكَ كَيْدَ. They might plot against you. They ended up plotting against him anyway, right? You know, I remember Imam Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala saying something that was really, I thought it was beautiful. And he said it sort of as a side note on this ayah, but I loved it. He said that, you know, had Ya'qub or had Yusuf told his brothers about the dream, they wouldn't have agreed to throw him in the well in the first place. They would have said, let's finish him off. They would have killed him right away. So the fact that Yusuf heeded the advice of his father and Ya'qub did not show that favoritism, but they still envied him and they threw him in the bottom of the well, you know, actually saved his life. It actually did translate into saving his life. And obviously, we know what happens after that. So these things might arise, and the shaitan doesn't need any help in creating envy between siblings or distancing between brothers and sisters. So when you're dealing with your children, don't pour gasoline on those flames that are already present sometimes between children, because that competitiveness is natural. So don't play it, because it might have a short-term benefit, but in the long term, it will distance your children from you and it will distance your children from each other. So it's not from the guidance of the Prophet to do that. And then, you know, to a hadith, and then I'll go into one more form of preference. You never find the Prophet ﷺ talking about wholesome justice and the reward of a person who is just in a wholesome sense without mentioning the family. So the hadith in Sahih Muslim, where the Prophet ﷺ says, إِنَّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَلَى مَنَابِرَ مِنْ نُورٍ عَنْ يَمِينِ الرَّحْمَنِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ, that verily, the dispensers of justice will be seated on pulpits of light beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the right side of the most merciful. And the Prophet ﷺ mentions who these people are. He mentions sallallahu alayhi wasallam, الَّذِينَ يَعْدِلُونَ فِي حُكْمِهِمْ وَأَهْلِيهِمْ, that those who are just with those who have been placed under their care, or just in their rulings, and with their families. So he specifies they show justice with their families. The Prophet ﷺ also mentions a person who dies, وَهُوَ غَاشٌ لِرَعِيَّتِي, and he is dishonest or cheats his flock. He cheats his flock. Remember the Prophet ﷺ said, كُلُّكُمْ رَاعٍ وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْؤُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَّتِي. One of the first narrations we covered in the series, all of you are shepherds, and all of you will be answerable to Allah about your flock. Your first flock is your family. Right? So the Prophet ﷺ mentions a person who dies, وَهُوَ غَاشٌ لِرَعِيَّتِي. He cheated his flock, meaning he was dishonest with his flock, or he deprived his flock, or didn't do what he should have with his flock. حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ. The Prophet ﷺ mentioned that paradise is forbidden from a person such as that. So that's something that it's important when we're talking about justice to those on the outside of the house, obviously justice amongst the children. The last form of preference I'll talk about is the preference with gender. Preference, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you boys, to show preference to boys in wanting sons over daughters. Obviously, this was something prevalent in the culture that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam dealt with. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned frequently, that's why you find so many ahadith about the rewards of raising daughters in particular. I mean, he's combating an extremely ignorant culture, a culture that shows extreme favoritism to boys to the point of killing their daughters. So all of these ahadith, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned, the one who's given daughters and behaves with goodness towards them and treats them well, they will serve as a protection for him on the Day of Judgment. Or he mentions, ﷺ, the one who takes care of three daughters and excels in his treatment of them, will be guaranteed paradise, the hadith in Abu Dawood. In fact, the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ where he mentioned, and you know, I've heard some people say there is no reward like the reward for taking care of an orphan. Right? Meaning that, the Prophet ﷺ said, I and the one who takes care of the orphan are like these two fingers. Just nod your head yes. Just act like you've heard it, right? You've all heard it, obviously. The Prophet ﷺ said that no one is given a daughter and raises them well, except that he will be like this with me on the Day of Judgment. So the hadith of the reward of taking care of an orphan also applies to taking care of a daughter, because the Prophet ﷺ was pushing back on these things. And that's why Salih ibn Ahmad mentioned that Imam Ahmad rahimahullah used to say that prophets were the fathers of girls. That prophets were the fathers of girls. Ya'qub ibn Bakhtan, he says that I had 7 daughters, and every time a daughter was born to me, Imam Ahmad rahimahullah would come to me and say, "Oh Abu Yusuf, the prophets were the fathers of girls. They were the fathers of daughters." And he would remind me of that blessing. And there's the ayah in Surah Ash-Shura, which is the 49th ayah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, لِلَّهِ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ يَخْلُقُ مَا يَشَاءُ. To Allah belongs the heavens and the earth. He creates what He wills. And then he mentions, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He gives يَهَبَهُ, or يَهَبُ, that He gives to those, لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ, to those that He wills. And he mentions إِنَاثَ, he mentions girls, and then he mentions يَهَبُ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives al-dhukur, that he gives to whom He wills sons. So when he mentions what he's gifting or what he gives, he mentions daughters and then he mentions sons. And that's not something that was lost on the mufassirin, on the scholars of tafsir. So for example, you'll find Wathila ibn al-Asqa' who mentions that it's from the blessings of a woman that gives birth to a female before male because Allah began with them first. You find a narration, or you find a long statement from Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, where he talks about this particular ayah, and he says, why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention girls before boys? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would gift girls, and He would gift boys. And so he gave different reasons that this could be in the ayah. He says, first and foremost, that he began with the mention of girls, and some of the scholars said that that was to console the girls that were mistreated or whose status was perceived as inferior. So he mentioned the first one, that was first and foremost to girls themselves that were put down and whose status was looked at as less than boys in that society. And he said it's also that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions liman yasha, that He is the one who wills, because the context of the discussion is that this is not the parents' will, this is Allah's will. Allah chooses who He gives girls to, Allah chooses who He gives boys to, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what He's doing. And so he also mentioned that in another view, he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave preference to what jahiliya, to what the people of the days of ignorance would deride to the point that they would bury young girls alive. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions girls in that fashion to show that preference in a way that would remind them of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Think about the 7th century here in Arabia and that harsh culture, and all of this is being taken into consideration, and this ignorance is being pushed back against in that strong fashion. He also mentions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the ayah mentions inatha. Allah mentions girls, and then He mentions al-dhukur, which are males, with the particular mention, the definite article of al, in front of boys and not in front of girls. And this is a hard one to really appreciate outside of the Arabic language. But Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah said, notice how he kept the word females, inatha, indefinite, by saying inatha without saying al-inatha. This is Ibn al-Qayyim saying this, not someone making this stuff up. And he said he used the definite article with males by saying al-dhukur, al-dhukur. And he said by doing that, he amends the perceived inferiority of the girl by bringing her forward. And he refers to her in that fashion, even without the al in the Arabic language. The point that he's trying to make is that it's a stronger expression to use the word girls without inatha, without the al, without the definite article before it, whereas Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses that with males. And that's, he wrote that in Tuhfat al-Mawdud bi Ahkam al-Mawlud, which is a book where he spoke particularly about the rulings in regards to children. So the point is that in some societies, in some cultures, as crazy as it may be, even today in the 21st century, you guys are thinking 7th century Jahili culture, But hey, it happens today too, where people make dua specifically for a boy, and it's like, it's got to be a boy. And if you get a girl the first time, they say, well, hopefully the next time around it'll be a boy, as if it was a fail the first time. And you think about how ugly that is. But it's real, and it happens in a lot of cultures, even with people that are supposedly educated and advanced in their knowledge. And the last thing that I'll mention here in regards to preferential treatment, what the scholars mentioned, the right to education, the right to educating the girl and the boy equally as well. That in some cultures and in some societies, it's an injustice that only the boys are educated without the girls, and this is something that's mentioned in our classical textbooks, that it's a right of both of the children to be taught and educated. And you have in that the example of Imam Malik, rahimahullah ta'ala, of whom his children, the greatest scholar of his children was actually his daughter Fatima. She memorized his collection of Al-Muwatta, and she used to teach his thousands of students the Muwatta of Imam Malik, the collection of hadith from Imam Malik, rahimahullah ta'ala. The scholars understood this value of imparting that knowledge and educating all of their children equally. So these are some of the things that the scholars mentioned here in regards to preferential treatment, whether that preference is based on a natural attachment, or whether that preference is based on gender, or whether that preference is based on the older child versus the younger child, that all of these things are to be taken into consideration. And if you have a people, remember the first thing the Prophet said to Nu'man ibn Bashir's father was, be conscious of Allah, ittaqillah, that be mindful of Allah. So when you have a generation of companions that feared Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so much and were so conscious and mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that they paid attention to how much they were kissing their children to make sure they were not unfair in that distribution, then what does that say about the way that we treat our children today, and how we sometimes could be unjust with our children? Yes, even on birthdays, make sure you give all your kids the same amount of gifts, even the ones that are nicer to you and the ones that are sometimes give you a harder time. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us just with our families, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us never to become unjust due to an injustice that was done to us. Allahumma ameen. Questions? I know there are going to be probably a few questions on this one, unless you guys are just too afraid to ask questions. Yeah, tafadhal, Shaykh. As-salamu wa rahmatullah. Yes. Well, there are going to definitely be different things to be taken into consideration with each gender. That doesn't mean that it has to be unjust. But for example, if it becomes to a point where it's oppressive towards one of your children over the other, then it becomes a problem. And I think that there are some things that are natural forms of oppression. So how society as a whole treats the sin of a girl versus the sin of a boy. Right, that's till today, and even in our communities, our American Muslim communities, a boy's sin is far less dishonorable, right, or dishonoring than a girl's sin at times. So that's also a form of injustice, it's a form of dhulm. So if that protectiveness is coming from a place of, I don't want you to dishonor me and things of that sort, that type of background, then it becomes problematic. But there are certain unique considerations that are often gonna take place with girls and boys, and not just with girls and boys because they're girls and boys, but some kids might require more restriction at time or more protectiveness at time, and that's fine. That's fine. That's not necessarily a harmful thing, but it should not be to a point where you're stepping on or squandering a person's right. I hope that makes sense. They're not black and white issues. They never are. So these are principles guiding principles that we have from the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. But then you have specific situations that we try to diagnose in light of those guiding principles.